वेलकम टू ऑनलाइन क्लास ऑन सीबी कृषि टू इन कंटिन्यूएशन ऑफ आवर प्रीवियस डिस्कशन रिगार्डिंग फीडिंग वी शुड लर्न द प्रोविजंस रिगार्डिंग फीडिंग इन ऑर्डर 6 ऑफ दिस बट इन प्रीवियस क्लास we are aware of the term bleeding. What is bleeding? Bleeding shall mean great or little strain. So when we say bleeding, it shall mean either great or little strain. So first rule of bleeding is that. What are the rules, general rules of bleeding? Those are mentioned in order 6. General rules. There are other two orders in the civil procedure code. One govern the length and the other set of rules govern the knitting strength. In order 7 we find what are the provisions to be compliant for filing a plate. Similarly, there are rules which rules are to be compliant for filing knitting strength. Now in order 6 we find general rules regarding bleeding are applicable to plaint and knitting strength. So first rule 2 provides that bleeding, that is every bleeding shall contain and contain only material fact, not law. What are material facts? The facts which are primary, which are very much required for decision of a case, for decision of a dispute in a civil suit. So bleeding shall contain only and contain only material facts, but not law, but not the evidence by which such facts have to be proved. Second, every bleeding must be divided into paragraphs or separate allegations. It should be pleaded in separate paragraphs. Third rule, date, sums, and number. Date, sum, number must be mentioned both in figure as well as in letter. Then that it was. Then form of the pleading. A particular form is available in Appendix A of the Civil Procedure Code. That form should be taken into consideration while preparing the plaint or written statement. That form will be followed as far as it is applicable in a particular case. Then Rule 4 provides that particulars to be given when necessary. What are the particulars? Particulars means some events in detail, amplifying the material facts. Suppose a misrepresentation is there, a fraud is there, how that misrepresentation occurred, how that fraud took place, all such facts, that is called particulars. Whenever necessary, particulars are to mention. So what it says, that pleading relief on any misrepresentation, fraud, breach of trust, willful default, or undue influence, and in all other cases in which particulars may be necessary. In such cases, some further facts are to be mentioned in the plaint or written statement to amplify, to clarify the main fact and issue or fact. So, that is called particulars in such cases. So in which cases particulars are to be mentioned? Particulars are to be given if a fact of misrepresentation is pleaded, undue influence is pleaded, then breach of trust, how that breach of trust occurred, how that misrepresentation took place, or how that willful default was made, all such particulars, wherever recovery is necessary, that must be mentioned. Then there's the other rule is that condition precedent. Suppose a suit is filed basing on a contract. If there was a condition precedent to be followed or to be complied either by the plaintiff or the defendant, the condition precedent, that must be pleaded, and the manner in which that condition precedent that has been complied, that must be pleaded in the either in the plaint or written statement. Similarly, no pleading shall except by way of amendment. There can be no new ground will be which is inconsistent with the earlier pleading can be taken. So what it means, no pleading shall except by way of amendment raise any new ground of claim or contain any allegation. No new ground of claim or allegation of fact inconsistent with previous pleading. If new ground of fact or allegation which are inconsistent with previous pleadings cannot be taken except by amendment. Then denial contract, when a contract is denied, but that is when there is a denial of a contract, that should be, it should be only construed. If a simply denial of a contract, it should be construed that only the contract is denied, but the legality of the contract is not denied. Once the contract is found to be true, then the other legal aspect is deemed to have been complied. It should be inferred that all legal requirements of the contract have been complied. Because if the defendant wants to deny the contract, he must take all sorts of defense, whether it is lawful or it is legal, it is binding. If the defendant in the written statement only denies the fact of entering into contract, but without denying the legality of the contract, and ultimately if it is proved that there was a contract, then it is to be inferred that the conclusion is to be drawn that other legal requirements of the contract have been complied, because the defendant does deny the legality of the contract. Similarly, the fact of document, when regarding a document, some fact is to be pleaded, that the effect of that document must be pleaded, but the detailed document must not be pleaded either in the plaint or in written statement. Suppose there is a safety that it may be pleaded that he got the title by virtue of that safety or by through that safety, but the entire safety should not be pleaded. Similarly, malice knowledge, when whenever it is material to allege any fraudulent intention, evil intention, that is malice, or knowledge or other condition of the mind, then itself is sufficient to allege the same as fact without setting out the circumstances in which such malice, such evil mind, that is to be involved. Whenever the fact of notice is to be read, then itself is sufficient to allege such notice as a fact, and the fact unless the form or the precise terms of such notice are denied. Now, implied contract, similarly, whenever any contract or any relation between the parties is to be implied from series of letters. Your either there may be express contract or implied contract. Like say, contract may be entered impliedly through some correspondence etc. by series of business letters. So if such implied contract is there, it is itself is sufficient to allege the contract or relation as a fact and to refer generally to such letters. It is not necessary that all such letters in detail must be mentioned in the pleading. Presumption of law, when there is a law which presumes a particular thing, particular fact, it need not be pleaded, because the pleading will contain material facts only, but not law. But when there is a presumption of law of a particular thing, particular right in favor of a particular person, that should not be pleaded unless the same has first been special denied, previously has been denied. Then third, this 14 says all pleadings must be signed. Who will sign? The party to the pleading, that is either plaintiff will sign, if more than one plaintiff, any of the plaintiff will sign it, or defendant will sign. So every pleading shall be signed by the party and his pleader, both the party and his pleader will sign the pleading. Provided that where a party pleading is by reason of absence of or other good cause unable to sign the pleading, it may be signed by any person duly authorized by him to sign the same or to sue or defend on his behalf. If a person, but you, a party is unable to remain present for signing the pleading because of some good reason, then any person duly authorized by him may sign the pleading. Now, Rule 14 says address for service of notice. It is called address registered address. What is address? So, along with the plaint and the written statement, but the statement mentioning the address of the parties must be filed with the court. So, what is the purpose? Because by requiring that address memo, court will send someone or notice to the parties. So, it is the Order 6, Rule 14 provides every pleading means either plaint or written statement when filed by a party, either plaintiff files or written statement is filed by the plaintiff, shall be accompanied by a statement in the prescribed form. In the prescribed form, registered address form is there for filing registered address, signed as a provided in Rule 14 regarding the address of the party. So, what it says? Every pleading, along with the plaint or the written statement, a statement signed by the party mentioning the address of the party is to be filed. Such address may from time to time be changed by lodging in court a form duly filled up and stating the new address of the party and accompanied by a verified petition. Suppose address may change. What is the purpose? The purpose is that throughout the pending of the suit, court is not supposed to search for the party's address. By filing the address memo, both the plaintiff and the defendants inform the court what is his address. So once that address memo is filed, that will be treated as the valid address, proper address of the party till the suit is decided. Even during till the appeal is this finally disposed of. So that's why this provision has been made in Order 6, Rule 14A, that requiring the plaintiff and the defendant to file a statement regarding his address, and signed by any party. Such address, suppose the address change of address takes place. So in such case, the person whose address is changed, he will inform the court regarding the change of his address in a prescribed form and accompanied by a verified petition. So now Rule 3 says the address furnished in the statement made under Sub-Rule 1, that means as per 14A, Rule 14A, Sub-Rule 1 provides, every pleading when filed by a party shall be accompanied by a statement in the prescribed form signed as provided in Rule 14, that is regarding the address of the party. His address is to be informed to the court. That is called registered address. So the address furnished by this statement, the party which files that statement regarding his address in the court, along with the plaint or the written statement, that is to be treated as the registered address of the party. And shall until newly changed, so long it has not been changed, then be deemed to be the address of the party for the purpose of all processes, all summons, all notices in the suit or in an appeal from any decree or order therein made. Even if an appeal is filed or any decree is appealed or any order is appealed or revision, etc. So in such case, and any decree or order therein made and for the purpose of execution, that registered address also will remain valid for the purpose of execution of the decree and shall hold good subject as aforesaid, but for a period of 2 years after the final determination of the cause of matter, even after the final decision of the issue, that address will remain as good, shall hold good as the address of the party, even for a period of 2 years from the date of final disposal of the case. Then service of any process may be affected upon a party at his registered address in all
as though such party resides there at Ajit. The party is residing there at all notices, all service, summons, all processes are to be sought to the particular party through that in that registered address. That is called a registered address. So here, where the registered address party is discovered by the, suppose the court discovers that a party has given a false address or party has given a fictitious address, what will happen? What the court will pass order in such case? Where the registered address of a party is discovered by the court to be incomplete, that the complete address is not mentioned in the address memo, false or fictitious. Suppose court finds that a party has given a false address or fictitious address, then the court may either in its own motion, either on suo voto or on the application of any party, or application of any party, what will pass order? That the in case where such registered address was furnished by a plaintiff, stay of the suit. Suppose the court is satisfied that the plaintiff was given a false address, the plaintiff was given incomplete address or fictitious address, then in such case, the either suo voto, court, either in own motion or on the petition of the defendant, may stay the proceeding, stay the suit. Similarly, in the case where such registered address was furnished by a defendant that is found to be false, fictitious, then his defense be struck out and he be placed in the sole position as if he had not put up any defense. So if it is found, court is satisfied that the defendant has given a false address in the address number or has not given complete address in the address number, registered address, and that is address memo file along with the written statement, or that is a fictitious, the court may order either suo voto or on the application of the plaintiff that the defense of the defendant be struck out and he will be put in the same position as if he had not filed any defense. So similarly, so this is the provision, or at this case may be order strike counting the defense. Court may also order that here is a defendant, he has given a false address, he has given a fictitious address, his defense be struck out. That means as if he has no defense and the plaintiff suit is to be decreed when there is no defense. So, but again a provision is there, the court is satisfied that the party was prevented by insufficient cause from filing the true address. Suppose the court is satisfied that the party, either the plaintiff or the defendant, have been prevented to file the correct, to furnish the correct address as per in the address, registered address memo, then the court shall set aside the order of stay if the plaintiff suit has been stayed, or shall they set aside the order of strike out in the defense if the order has been passed to strike out the defense of the defendant on such terms as to cost or otherwise as it thinks fit, and shall appoint a day for proceeding with the suit or defense as the case may be. So nothing in this rule shall prevent the court from directing the service of a process at any other address if for any reason it thinks fit to do so. That's because there is a registered address, that statement has been filed by the party, that will not prevent the court to pass order for service of summons in any other address. This is a provision which has been inserted by way of amendment in the year 1976. So what it says, that is registered address. Why? The purpose is that to save delay in trial. For all purpose, there should be that means a fixed address of the party. The address of the party must be known to the court, and that address must remain as a correct address till the disposal of the suit, even for a period of 2 years from the date of disposal of the case. Now, Order 6 Rule 15 provides verification of claim, save as otherwise provided by any law for the timely enforcement. If there is any other law, that will not be affected. Save by any other law for the timely enforcement. Every pleading shall be verified at the foot. At the foot of the pleading, that should be verified. Foot of the pleading means what? In the foot of the plaint or foot of the written statement. So if any other law requires any other verification, that is to be also compliant. Same as otherwise provided in any other law, every pleading shall be verified at the foot of it by a party or one of the parties pleading, or any of the party, or by some other person, proved to the satisfaction of the court to be acquainted with the fact of the case. Then who will verify? Either of the party or any of the party or any other person, even a third person who is acquainted with the facts and circumstances of the case, you can verify the pleading, both plaintiff, plaint or the written statement. So this is called verification. The person verifying shall specify by reference to the numbered paragraphs. When a verification is to be made, plaint is to be verified or written statement is to be verified, because the rules of pleadings provide that every pleading must be verified at the foot of the pleading. Pleading means either it is a plaint or written statement. So both plaint and the written statement are to be verified by whom? By party or one of the parties or any other person who is acquainted with the facts and circumstances of the case. Say for example, a son filed a suit, but his son is not a party. If his son is aware of the facts and the circumstances of the case, he can also verify. While verifying the plaint or written statement, it must be clearly mentioned by the person verifying which of the paragraphs he verifies according to his personal knowledge, or which of the paragraphs of the plaint or written statement he verifies according to the information from other sources. So that has been provided. The person verifying shall specify by reference to the numbered paragraphs of the pleading. As you are previously, you are aware, so pleading must be what? In paragraph, consecutive will be numbered, and sorry, 1, 2, etc., that all those paragraphs. So the person who verifies, he will, such verification is to be made referring the numbered paragraphs of the pleadings. What he verifies of his own knowledge, which of the paragraphs of the pleading he verifies according to his own knowledge, and which he verifies upon information received and believed to be true. There may be some facts for which a person has no personal knowledge, but he has received the information and he believes to be true. So that's why, so at the time of verification, it must be mentioned by the person verifying that which of the paragraph of the plaint, consecutively numbered or numbered paragraph of the plaint, he verifies according to his own information and belief or according to his own knowledge. Then the person verifying the pleading shall also furnish an affidavit in support of his pleadings. Then all plaint and the written statement must be supported with affidavit. This is included by way of amendment in the year 1999. So now the pleadings are to be supported by affidavit, both written statement and the plaint. Then another this, the verification shall be signed by the person making it and shall state the date on which and the place at which it was verified. So the person who verifies must mention the date and the place where he verified the plaint or the register. So you are aware what is verification. Verification means what? So he has gone to me, he subsequently cannot say that I was not aware of this facts which I pleaded. By verification he affirms, reaffirms the but his contention that his contentions are true. Whatever he has mentioned in the plaint or in the written statement are with his knowledge, because he is verifying. Once a verification is made, subsequently he cannot say that he was not aware of the particular fact as pleaded and his advocate has mentioned it without his knowledge. So that's why abundant precautions have been taken by the legislature that all what pleadings must be verified. What verification shall be signed by the person making it and shall state the date on which and the place at which it is verified. So the person verifying the pleading shall also furnish an affidavit in support of his pleadings. So now, striking out of pleadings. This is a provision in Order 6, Rule 16. A question may come, when pleadings are to be struck out? What the provision says? The court may at any stage of the proceeding order to be struck out or amend any matter in any pleading. The court has been given this, that the ample power has been unbridled power, unrestricted power to pass any order or to strike out a pleading or to pass order for amendment of it. When? Suppose some unnecessary facts have been pleaded. Those are cumbersome. There is silly matters have been pleaded. And those pleadings are not required. So it is vexatious. It will cause unnecessary delay in trial. So in such case, the court may direct that pleadings of a particular party may be struck out. Or the court may also direct a party, please amend your plea. Or please amend your written statement. Because these are scandalous, unnecessary things. Some unnecessary allegations have been made against a party or which are not required for the court so to decide. So what it says, the court may at any stage of the proceedings order to be struck out or amend any matter in any pleading. So this power can be exercised both in respect of plain and the written statement, because pleadings have been this plain or written statement. So that's why the court may at any stage of the proceeding before passing judgment, at any stage means before passing judgment, order to be struck out or amend any matter in any pleading. The court may order that a particular matter be struck out, the particular matter be amended. When, which may be unnecessary, those matters are unnecessary for the suit, but those acts have been pleaded. Or scandalous, frivolous, vexatious. Scandalous means immoral, etc. Alleging some, making some false allegations are there, which may tend to prejudice, embarrass, or delay the fair trial of the suit. On that ground, the court may order that the pleading be struck out or the pleading be amended, which is otherwise an abuse of the process of the court. If a question comes, when the court will pass order to strike out the pleading or when the court will pass order to amend the pleading, the answer is Order 6, Rule 16. It provides the court may at any stage of the proceeding, that is prior to passing final judgment, may pass order to strike out pleading of a party or to direct a party to amend its pleading when in three circumstances. First, which may be unnecessary, scandalous, frivolous. Three, unnecessary, scandalous, frivolous. First circumstance. Second, which may tend to prejudice, embarrass, or delay the fair trial of the case. Prejudice, delay, and embarrass the fair trial of the case. Third is, which is authorized and abuse of the process of the court. What is abuse of the process? Unnecessary somebody is dragged to the litigation. If that pleading will be considered, it will be taken into account, then somebody will be unnecessarily dragged to the litigation. Now, Order 6, Rule 17 is very, very important provision. That is amendment of the pleading. Amendment pleading means both amendment can be plain, can be amended, written statement can be amended. You are either, though no new facts which are inconsistent with pleadings, previous pleading can be taken by a party without amending his pleading. So that's why 17 provides, the court may at any stage of the proceeding, that is even that is any stage of the proceeding means prior to passing of judgment, allow either party. Either party means either the plaintiff or the defendant. Or amend his pleading in such manner and of such terms. In what manner that amendment will be made? According to which terms? Regarding cost, etc. Such manner and such terms as may be just. As may be just. You should give importance to the word just. As may be just. And all such amendment shall be made as may be necessary. Just and necessary. These two words you should give importance. As may be just. And all such amendment may be necessary for the purpose of determining the real question in controversy between the parties. Just and necessary for the purpose of determining the real question in controversy between the parties. This is Order 6, Rule 17. What it provides? The court may, at any stage of the proceeding, what? Allow either party, either to plaintiff or the defendant, to amend his pleading on such terms as may be just, and necessary. What for? For the purpose of determining the real question in controversy between the parties. You should get this. Pleading will be amended only when it is just. Just is proper. It is required for determining the real necessary to determine the real question in controversy between the parties. So that's why. But one restriction is imposed by your amendment in the year 2002. Once the parties have adduced their the trial has commenced, such an amendment will not be allowed unless the party satisfies the court that in spite of his due diligence, he could not bring such amendment. This provision says, provided that no application for amendment shall be allowed after the trial has commenced, that means hearing has commenced, unless the court comes to the conclusion that in spite of due diligence, in spite of all reasonable care, the party could not have raised the matter before the commencement of the trial. The party could not have raised the matter which he wants to bring to the knowledge of the court, bring to pleading by OM amendment, could not be brought to the knowledge of that party. So this is Order 6, Rule 17. What it says, the court may at any stage of the proceeding, even prior to passing of a judgment, court may permit a party to amend his pleading on such term which is just and such term and which are necessary for what? This effective adjudication of the matter in dispute, determining the real question in controversy between the parties. To determine the real question in controversy between the parties. But once the trial has commenced, then such application for amendment will not be allowed unless the party seeking amendment satisfies the court that prior to commencement of trial, in spite of his own care, he was not aware that such an amendment was not necessary for the purpose of his this claim or defense. That is Order 6, Rule 7. Now, although this Rule 18 provides, when court allows amendment, a particular day fixed time is to be given to complete the amendment, to make such amendment. If no time is given, then within 14 days from the date of order, such amendment will be made. Then if it is not done within the stipulated time, then that amendment will be refused. Now this Order 6, Rule 18 provides, if a party who has obtained an order for leave to amend does not amend accordingly within the time limited for the purpose by the order, usually the court, while passing order for amendment of the plaint or written statement, fix a particular date by which such amendment will be made, either in the plate or in the writ statement. Or if no time is thereby limited, suppose the court doesn't fix any time, no time is given, or within, or court passes within 7 days, such amendment will be carried out. Or within 15 days, that will be carried out. Okay, then within that 15 days, that amendment will be done. So if no time is fixed by the court, and in such case, he shall not, then in such case, no time is thereby limited, then within 14 days from the date of the order, then such amendment will be made within 14 days from the date of passing of the amendment order. If such amendment is not done, is not carried out by either by the party, then he shall not be permitted to amend after the expiration of such limited time as aforesaid. That means within the time fixed by the court, no time is fixed within 14 days from the date of the order. If such amendment is not done, then the court will not refuse such amendment unless the time is extended by the court. The court may also give time, but that amendment will be made within the time fixed by the court. Or if no time is given in the order, then within 14 days from the date of the order, if it is not done, then he shall not be permitted to amend after the expiration of such limited time. That the party will not be permitted to amend his plate or written statement after the expiration of such time fixed or 14 days from the date of order, unless the court extends the time. This is not said, the provisions regarding amendment in reading. Now we completed our discussion on Order 6 of the Civil Procedure Code, which provide general rules of reading. If you have any doubt regarding any of the provision, you may say, inform me through message, and we'll try to clarify you in the next class. Thank you.